Now throughout this download, we're basically going to start at the top of the body and look at major areas to see how they can be deformed on the receiving end as we're fighting, moving through a dynamic, and how they can be deformed actively in our opponents. First thing we're going to look at is our neck and our head. So if we think in a striking context, naturally, it is impossible for us, we would not want to walk through our regular life perpetually hunched over in a primal state. We want to have good elongation, want the back of the nape nice and engaged, lengthened out, the chin is down, just like we always do in our level one spinal check, and this gives us good fluidity and balance in the neck. The moment we see ourselves in an opposite end of the spectrum, more combative environment, we want to see that chin at minimum coming down, shortening the lever of the neck as we've seen before, and those shoulders now are not only up, but more mobile enough, meaning that they have the potential to always go higher up and to move, but they're simply not flaccid. Remember, a cardinal rule of grappling and boxing is that we want to stay in a state of perpetual motion. So in boxing it might look like us testing how we can shorten the chin, bring up the shoulder, move with the head all the time to keep it elastic and in motion so it's harder for them to time. In grappling it can look similar. The head will oftentimes couch in and turtle in quite a bit when somebody goes to grab us. Ways we do not wish to deform our own neck is we do not want to start looking down or looking away. So the use of our sight is very, very important. A lot of times people will flinch. So in all of our boxing work, we always try to squint and basically stare right through the rein as it comes towards us. And this is easier said than done. The key to this is operating at a threshold of stress that you can manage when you test yourself until you just start to have moments of failure or moments where you're feeling overwhelmed. Doesn't mean you're necessarily looking away, but it means that after a minute or two, all right, you've had enough, you need a little break. That's a good pressure test. And it means that in your drilling, you're actively adding elements of evasion in ideal circumstances, hitting pads and moving, always teaching yourself not to look away. And then if you start to integrate things like controlled combinations that involve evasion and slipping and shielding, you want to make sure that if you know you're going to give a 1-2 and a shield, that when you're doing that shield, you're not looking away then, because you're in control of that destiny. You fully want to reinforce, at minimum, a sort of peripheral stare over the elbow or through the elbow window as you work. So that's where you perfect it. You do not simply realize it cognitively and then spar and spar and spar and hope to see it come out in the wash. It simply will not, right? It could over a very long and inefficient period of time, but the greatest probability is you're going to keep on flinching. So you need to test it and you need to integrate it in your drills. Eyes forward all the time. When we box, when we grapple, when we're against weapons, there's also the tendency for the eyes to fixate. People will look at the legs before they shoot, they'll stare at the knife before they defend. And as we've seen in previous downloads, some level of target fixation is normal. Elite performers do this all the time. They will look at a few different targets, sweep through them, and then usually reduce or funnel them down to the priority targets and then scan through those continuously like a circuit. What you do not want to do is simply fixate on something and forget about the rest of the body. So don't tell yourself, I'm not allowed to look at the feet when I'm looking at footwork, or I can never look at the knife. Do look at the knife, but then consider the shoulders, see the feet in the peripheral, look back at the knife, glance routinely. Prolong those thresholds where you have the chance to see on the perimeter and distance, or when you're clinching, or when you're on the ground, and learn to see different parts of the body. At first, you might choose the wrong ones. You might have, you might be looking at the hip when you should be focusing on the hand, or whatever the case is. That's fine. What's important is that you're encouraging the eyes to scan, and you're looking at multiplicity, you're teaching your brain to process, and inadvertently or consciously, you're building the strength of your peripheral vision. These are all things that are very, very important. As the eyes become more reliable, and as your body structure becomes more familiar, the two will complement each other rather than fight against one another. When you're grappling, very often, you'll see people will constantly be trying to snap down the neck, and so very often people try to escape by bringing the head down. So that's another place, just like boxing and slipping, where I should be trying to keep the eyes up. And if I'm slipping under anything, I should always have the eyes looking up in the upper peripheral vision. So we can reinforce that in any kind of light grappling. We can reinforce that in our weight work. If you're doing body weight or physical weights and you're lifting, a lot of times people have the habit of looking down or looking up all the way when they lift. Try to make sure you're working your vision all the time. Everything should relate tactically, because as we get into a lot of these ideas of striking or stirring the body to disrupt the head, if the majority of your pressure is coming from body weight or physical weight exercises, and you're lifting, and you're going to great strain and great exhaustion, and teaching your eyes to go everywhere but forward, and some people even closing their eyes on their bench press or whatever the case may be, then it's no surprise that if that's the majority of your pressure testing, that when you get into a really hard grapple and you inadvertently start using too much power, close your eyes, hold your breath, and act exactly like you did in the gym. So we need consistency across the spectrum. You must work up in the gym the way you move through your regular life, the way you want to function in a combat scenario. Because in that crisis, you're not going to have gains. You're going to have reduction. Reduction of fine motor, reduction of control, reduction of cognitive direction. And so you're going to see whatever grade you have get greatly diminished. And if you're just harboring at a bare passing grade for function in the gym, the fight is going to take you into failure zone. So please be mindful of all of this as we go forward into all of the domains of alignment affectation to make sure that we have the most complete, synergistic, and efficient body possible.